I've been on 317 failed dates, which means that I know better than at least some of you that dating can be really hard. But over the past year, I've learned that even my dating woes pale in comparison to those facing fireflies. Right now, I'm really feeling for the male Photinus nuli, or Southwest synchronous firefly. You see, every night is ladies' night at the Firefly nightclub, and these ladies have high standards. The males must engage in a dazzling display, blinking their lights in unison to attract female mates. If and only if there are enough male suitors to choose from, the ladies will pick one to go home with that night. But lately, someone has been turning on the overhead lights and it's dampening the mood. I'm talking about artificial light or human-made light pollution that is disrupting the nightly mating rituals of the Southwest synchronous firefly. Light pollution brightens the night sky, and growing light pollution around the world is affecting the lives and health of ecosystems of all types and sizes. Where I live in the Sonoran Desert, we often take the incredible biodiversity and near pristine dark skies for granted. But even in this desert, light pollution is creeping in. And the local plants, animals, insects, and people are all feeling its impacts. Through my experiences working at some of the world's most beloved desert observatories, including the Mount Lemmon Sky Center and the Smithsonian Astrophysical Observatory's Whipple Observatory, I'm going to lead you through some of the challenges facing both bugs and people as a result of light pollution. We're also going to dive into some of its other impacts and how dialing back light pollution can help to protect and sustain the health of our world for generations to come. But let's first go back to our bioluminescent friends, the firefly. Bioluminescence has glittered like stars on Earth for over 540 million years, and it's almost impossible to pinpoint how many species of bioluminescence are alive today. Scientists recently estimated that there were 76% of ocean life alone were bioluminescent, but as recently as May 2024, a group of researchers at Florida International University, led by Stormy Collins, discovered 157 new species of bioluminescent shrimp living on the ocean floor. Even in the desert, you can find bioluminescence if you just stop and look. On a particularly humid night in July 2023, for instance, I stood in the dark with a group eager to witness the mesmerizing dance of the Southwest synchronous firefly. And two striking facts emerged for me that evening. The first is that despite what some prominent scientists have claimed, blinking fireflies do in fact reside west of the Rocky Mountains. And second is that although fireflies traditionally thrive at low, warm, and moist elevations, they can also flourish in some unexpected locations. Driven by my own curiosity, I launched Project Glowworm to track unexpected bioluminescence in the Santa Rita Mountains near Whipple Observatory. And between July and September 2024, firefly expert Dr. Joe Cicero and I found not one, but two genera of glowworms living above 8,000 feet. We also found some compelling evidence for blinking fireflies at these heights and higher. That these blinking fireflies and their glowworm cousins are not merely charming. They also play a vital role in our ecosystem as pollinators and natural pest control. They feast on slugs and snails, and they move pollen from plant to plant, balancing the ecosystem. Their mating rituals also can tell us a lot about the impacts of light pollution in this region and beyond. You see, under the glare of light pollution, fireflies struggle to find their soulmates. And since many of them live just a few weeks after reaching adulthood, they don't have much time to reproduce and become the pollinators that we need them to be. Glowworms, they face even greater dating pressures, since most of them live just a few days after reaching adulthood. Now, that same light that is impacting fireflies is also causing problems at places like Whipple Observatory and the Sky Center, where researchers are looking up. A favorite pastime in southern Arizona is driving up Mount Lemmon outside of Tucson to gaze upon the golden dome created by the city's sprawling lights. But for astronomers, this light dome is a problem. You see, light domes or sky glow are blankets of light that obstruct our view of the night sky, making it difficult for all of us to see dim stars and other celestial objects. For example, residents of rural Amado, Arizona enjoy breathtaking views of the night sky, but just 45 miles away in downtown Tucson, we're deprived of the celestial spectacle. And we're not alone. More than 83% of the global population lives under light-polluted skies, and more than a third will never have the opportunity to see the Milky Way. Our view of the night sky is fading fast as cities grow and our connection to the cosmos becomes increasingly tenuous. But animals like fireflies and people are not the only creatures living on borrowed night. Cacti and agave, along with non-desert food-bearing plants like pineapple and grapes, rely on darkness to collect carbon dioxide, which they use in photosynthesis to create their own food. But light pollution disrupts this process and can have negative impacts on their nutrition and their health. Other plant species like mimosa, acacia, multiple types of beans, tulips, poppies, and even globe mallow exhibit a nighttime behavior known as nictinesty, essentially a sleep mode where they close their petals and leaves. These plants, like humans, have circadian rhythms, and the ability to rest is crucial to their health. What's more, these plants don't sleep alone. Bumblebees and other species often seek refuge in the cozy embrace of closed flowers at night. But light pollution is disrupting plant sleep, effectively shutting down these bee hotels. Light pollution also disrupts those working the ecosystem night shift. The stunning queen of the night opens her blossom into darkness for pollination by nocturnal bats and moths. Night migrating birds like orioles eat her seeds and disperse them under cover of darkness. But if the queen is tricked by light pollution into not opening her blossom, these animals cannot perform their duty to protect and proliferate her ecosystem. As I'm reflecting on all of these interconnected issues, I'm really thinking of the night skies from my childhood. I'm 39 years old, and those skies are already a fading memory, just something I think many of you can probably relate to. And I don't want to be 50 or 60 years old and find myself straining my eyes through an overlit barren landscape for the once vibrant sparkle of fireflies and wishing on stars I can no longer see. I believe so deeply in the power of the night sky to inspire and change our lives that I'm leading a program at the Smithsonian called STARS, which aims to put a telescope and astronomy curriculum in every rural and tribal nation school across America. We believe, since the sky is free for everyone, that astronomy can serve as a gateway to science, technology, engineering, and mathematics for all children. But I can't shake this nagging question. How do we ensure that our children have the opportunity to explore dark skies and everything that relies upon them? I envision a world where our night skies remain dark and accessible, where everyone in this room and their children's children can enjoy a night sky illuminated not by artificial light, but by the glow of fireflies, the shimmer of stars, and the low hum of snoring bees tucked inside snoozing flowers. A world where even my youngest future astronomers will look up into the night sky one day and discover distant galaxies without the hindrance of light domes and glare. And the thing is, that future is well within our grasp. Because light pollution is one of those rare global challenges where the actions of small communities and individuals can make the biggest impact. In fact, those solutions are deceptively simple. All of you can go home today and you can replace the bright white LEDs at your home or business with amber-colored ones at 2700 Kelvin or below. These bulbs are readily available at grocery and hardware stores. You can also opt for fully shielded light fixtures, which direct light downward to where humans need it most. This one action on your part can reduce upward light pollution by up to 75%. And paired with those light bulbs, the impact is even greater. Third, you can follow or encourage the development of outdoor lighting codes, which guide the use of outdoor light in local ecosystems. But perhaps the most important action you could take is this. Turn out the lights, allowing darkness to reclaim its rightful place. And always, always keep looking